So we are going to get started, and I am very happy to be introducing Karen Chan. She is a professor at the Hong Kong University of Science and Technology, and she grew up in Hong Kong and did her undergraduate there at the University of Hong Kong. And then her last year in college, she did an exchange year at UC Davis. So she spent a year working at UC Davis doing marine science research, and then after that she started her PhD at the University of Washington working with Danny Grunbaum, and that's where I met Karen. We both were in that program at the same time, and when she was there she was studying larvae and how individuals move and respond to changes in the environment and how their shapes change. This is my non-expert synopsis of what Karen does. And she even had time to contribute to my PhD thesis, and we published a paper together. And then after she graduated from UW, she was a postdoc scholar at the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institute, and there she kind of continued the same type of research of looking at individual behavior of larvae, but she used a new technique called particle imaging velocimetry, which is kind of like she'll show some examples of that today. I made her put a video in so you guys can see. And now she is a professor, now she has her professor position in Hong Kong, but this year she's doing an exchange, a faculty exchange down at Caltech, so that's why we get to have her here today. And I'll let you.
Thank you, Colleen. Thank you, Colleen, and thank you, everyone. I'm very excited to be here. This is my second time ever here in Monterey. The first time I was in Monterey, I was an undergrad working at UC Davis. It was my birthday gift to go to Mbari to sample the mud core, and I think it's the coolest thing for a 21-year-old. Instead of drinking, you go sample deep sea sediments. So that's the kind of nerd that I am, and I still have that passion. I mean, I still love 4AMs, but I love these guys a little bit more. We will be talking about these things, so let's just start and make sure that everybody is on the same page. Does anybody recognize what kind of animals is shown on the title slide? If you already know who they are, please put your hands up. We will get there. I have one, I have two, okay. We'll get there shortly. So today I'll share with you the work that I've been doing since graduate school and then a lot of the work that my lab is currently doing in Hong Kong. The gist of it is we want to investigate how human activity are actually impacting our coastal ecosystem and what does it mean for those early life history stages. So think about as we're looking at what the babies are doing in a sea of change. So just to orient you to what we're talking about, I'll start with why we study larvae. I understand some of you probably work with the early life stages of marine invertebrate too, but we'll just bear with me, I'll quickly go through that. Then I'll give you three case studies, three vignettes of different work that we've been doing in my lab, from ocean warming to ocean acidification, and some of the new works that we've been working on microplastics. And I'll give you a sneak peek on interactive stressors that we're doing. I will try to take the time because I understand I'm water standing you between you and your free booze. So I'll make sure that I am on time, so I won't belabor on that. I'll give you some take-home message at the end. So before I go anywhere further, I have to acknowledge a lot of the work that I'm going to tell you about is done by my lab group. So I run the Quantitative Plankton Ecology Lab, or short CUPID in Hong Kong. Like Colleen said, we study how plankton interact with the fluid environment. So we are in the Chinese society, so sitting around round table is a lot of things that we do, and students once in a year throw me a party. Instead of having me pay for their food, they buy me a birthday gift. So that's my group. So what do we do? As I said, we study the interactions between plankton and the fluid environment. We particularly focus on the life history, stages of marine invertebrates. So some of you already know what they are, and just want to make sure that you know the key players that I'll talk about. So I'm going to give you 30 seconds to talk to your neighbor and figure out what kind of animals you think you're looking at. Hint, they are all invertebrate. I don't study fish in my lab. So what would they be when they grow up? So I'm going to give you 30 seconds. Any guesses of any of the four? Oh, just anyone. Start with anyone. Where?
On the bottom left.
Okay. This one. This is a sea urchin. Perfect. Any other guesses? Yes.
Crabzilla.
This is a Crabzilla. Yes.
Mollusk larvae. Very top.
Mollusk larvae. Very top. Great. Yeah. Very good. Last one. I throw in one that is not as easy. Any guesses? Huh? Is it a worm? Very good. So these are actually all animals that we worked with in my lab, so that's why I have to showcase them here. This is the purple sea urchin we have in Hong Kong, ecologically the same as your Strongyles and Trogus purpuranus. So it's very similar urchin morphology, except that they have pretty little red spot. So the person that said mollusks, larvae, a villager, particularly of a slipper limpet, is actually Capitula onyx. It's the one that you have here in California. We have them as an invasive in Hong Kong. The Crabzilla, perfect answer, specifically Portunus pelagicus, so swimming blue crab. Asians love eating them. Last but not the least, the wormy thing, perfect guess. This is a Phoronid worm, so they have an actinotroph larva. Very, very beautiful. This is some of the result from our biodiversity survey in Hong Kong. So these are the things that we worked with, and I hope I've convinced you part of the reason why they were studying is that they are uniquely adapted to the planktonic environment. They look very different from their adult, and they're definitely pretty. So like what Colleen said, the first question that we ask in my lab is, how do environmental factors shape the organism's performance? So what would happen if we change the temperature of the water? How do they respond? How do they react? What is the mechanism? What are the implications? The other part of my lab is, putting it in reverse, is how do the organism affect their environment? More specifically, we look at biomechanics. So how do they move water around them? So that's the particle image velocimetry that Colleen was talking about. What is unique about this approach is that it's a flow field, so I'm sorry, it should be plain nonstop. So what you're looking at is a small monocle larva swimming in water, and we take image of it at 8,000 frames per second, and now you're slowing it down way, way, way slow. So what you can do is then you can untangle all the flow field around it and look at how much forces is exerted in this environment, how efficient it is at moving the water around it. And we're asking a lot of questions of form and function. Why do they have these little horn things? What are they for? If they have longer spine, what does it mean? But we will shelve biomechanics for another day. If you're interested, I'm happy to talk to you in excruciating details of how we do biogeometric morphometrics and what does this kind of flow analysis look like. Or I'll even show you how we actually do surgery on these little guys. But ask me at the end, we can talk about it. So those are the two main questions that my group work on, how organisms impact the environment, how environment impacts the organism, how organisms impact the environment. But why larvae? Well, because they are very important for dispersal. So this is where I started. I started working on Sandala, that Adrasta eccentricus, when I was a graduate student. You can imagine a Sandala or a sea urchin have very limited mobility as an adult. They can't crawl very far. And they have this free spawning that gamete fertilize in the ocean, so you can think of it as this stage to go far. And if you care about how the population would change with the environment, you need to understand whether they can be restocked. Think about them as seed. So we need to study this very critical life stage. In addition, as being a vehicle of dispersal and connecting genetic distinct population, is that they are very vulnerable. So this is a very crude estimation. This is how old a larvae would be. This is number of individuals. An individual sand dollar can produce 350,000 eggs, one female. But their mortality is typically estimated by a logarithmic curve. So what you would have, the number of individuals that have at the end of a 10-day planktonic duration is very different from what you have on 15 days. So what it means is that whatever you do to the small larva, if you delay the growth, it stays in the plankton longer, you have a higher risk of mortality. And if you translate it into climate change research, very often we see delay in growth. And it would then translate into a population level change. So that's why we study larvae, they're important. And in particular, my group works a lot on larval behavior. It sounds very oxymoronic, right? They're planktonic, which means they cannot swim against the current. Then why are you doing behavior? Well, it's because a lot of the environmental factors that are crucial for growth and development, think your temperature, your salinity, your pH, is not uniform in the water column. Your food, the chlorophyll, often you have thin layers. Predators, zooplankton, and fish, they don't evenly distribute it throughout the water column. So as the currents. So if small larvae can swim up and down in response to cues, they might end up, think of as riding a different highway and eventually end up in a different place. To give you an example, my PhD student did this work. So the experiment is pretty simple and straightforward. If you imagine you create a salinity gradient, and using that halo climb, you have either normal pH or low pH water on top, or reverse, you have normal pH or low pH water on top, and look at where will the sand dollar larvae go. What is very interesting is that if your acidic water is on top, they don't swim towards the top. They get kind of hanging out at right the halo climb. But if the normal water is on top, they go right to the top. So this very simple experiment illustrates to you that a lot of marine invertebrate larvae, including those of urchins, have ability to respond to different environmental cues, such as pH. So behaviors can then affect dispersal outcome. If they grow better in one pH than the other, then it makes a difference. So behavior matters. That's why we study behavior. Okay, so that's motivation and who we are, what we do. Let's get into the meat of it. So some example of the work we do. So in the first case study, I would invite you to join me in the tropics. This is the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute in Bocas del Toro in Panama. Beautiful place in the Caribbean. This is the reef that you would look right outside the lab. And if you are very lucky, once in a while, your two-toed sloth will come right by your field site and you get to look at the sloth. So this is the backdrop of the research, and why do we do it in the tropics? Well, because our planet is warming. This is probably something that you're very familiar with. Present day PCO2 level is already exceeding 400 microatmospheres. And if you compare to data from 1950s to way back, we've increased about another half a degree. And if you stick to the IPCC prediction, by the turn of the century, average ocean temperature is going to warm by another 0.6 to even up to a degree. So the ocean is warming at an unprecedented rate on average. But in the tropics, it's happening even faster. So Bocas del Toro is this area, so the lab is actually right there. So this is the Blastimentos area. It's a marine reserve by the Panamanian government. What you're looking at is predicted sea surface temperature for a day in August. In 2010, 2024, 2054, and 2084. So I'm not talking even about at the end of the century, I'm talking about a little bit earlier than that. You're going with at around 30 degrees to 33 degrees. I'm talking about a 3 degrees warm up in 80 years of time. And we're getting there fast. So that's why we're very interested in studying this particular very shallow reef habitat. And it also has other distinctive features, including hypoxia in certain months, and that's why we work there. So using this very interesting system, and caveat is, I didn't know there was sloth until I get to Panama, so the sloth was the bonus, is we want to ask the question, can tropical species survive warming? So why this? Well, the tropic is warming even faster in the shallow reef area. And the other reason is that if you study physiological hypothesis, which is something like this. So you have temperature on the x-axis, you have some kind of performance, and there is a curve. If the temperature is really low, whatever measurement that you do, growth, oxygen, respiration, behavior, it's not really good. It's too cold to do anything. Think about you on a cold winter day. Or if it is too hot, then degradation of proteins happen, then function is decreased. So everything has some kind of optimum temperature. And what Hans Pointer argued is that any other stressor decreases that curve. So for organisms in the tropic, the maximum ambient temperature right now should be very close to the optimum already. Because if an organism is well adapted, it should get as close and as efficient as it can be. But what it means is that if climate change pushes it a few degrees warmer, their performance will be compromised even faster compared to the temperate species, which has a larger, what we call, thermal safety margin. So if that's the case, so we would hypothesize tropical species are living right up to their thermal limit, and they are very at risk of global warming. So that's the first question that we are asking. On top of that, we ask two more questions. They are, okay, if we care about this kind of thermal limits, can we just use one measurement and represent all of them? Because I just show you, like an urchin, there are so many life history stages. Can I just measure the adult and call it good? Or do I have to measure every single stage once? And if you think about designing your experiment, does acclimation make a difference? If the organism is collected from 25 degrees water versus the organism collected from 28 degrees water, are they going to give you different physiological performance? If they do, then it means that how we design experiments also should take into acclimation into account. So that's why we are asking this three questions. This is how we address it. So to address the first question of, are they living close to the thermal limit? And are there differences between stage? What we do is we take a sea urchin and we induce them spawning. How many of you have ever done it? Those people must be from the larval lab or ecology. Okay. So for Californian sea urchins, if you're very lucky, you can shake them. They will give you their gametes. But for the tropical sea urchins, we imagine alien abduction. You scoop them out of the water by snorkeling. And then you put them up in somewhere that is dry with bright light in your lab, and then you poke them with needles and inject them with chemical called KCL, same thing that you do in needle injection. And then they freak out, and then they give you their gametes and you fertilize. So this is what we do. That's the reason why it is really nice to work with invertebrates. I don't have to go through IOCOC or human subject panel. So what we do is when we have the urchins, we fertilize them and we watch them cleave and they develop into a molar. And what we then did is we exposed them to a temperature gradient. So imagine cooking them slowly. And then we are counting the proportion of them surviving. It's very similar to what you do in ecotoxicology. You would call it LD50, lethal dosage 50. What we are doing here is calculating lethal temperature. So we are exposing the different stages across the temperature gradient, and we look at the temperature at which 50% of them are surviving. So the color code corresponds. So you can see that fertilization can still happen at
at around 34 degrees. Cleavage lower. Early blastular and molar development is even lower. So answer kind of the second question, right? One size doesn't fit all. If we include the actual larval stage, which is this thing, the fluteus, it's the black line. It suddenly gets better, so it's closer to the fertilization. So this is the number pulled out. So you go from 34 degrees in fertilization, but molar development is 32. Adult is 35. So what it suggests is that if you go out and only take an adult urchin and measure it and say, oh, they will survive up to 35 degrees, you might be missing a very critical bottleneck. They would have cooked before. So early stages worth investigating, and it makes a difference. And what does it translate into Ate living in the current limits? So what is beautiful in this site is they're already underwater temperature logger. So we pooled at Isla Patrolis, one of the sites is a seagrass site where we collect all the urchins there here. We look at what is the average month temperature, and we counted the number of hours that is current at present that is exceeding 32 degrees, 32 degrees at which the molar development doesn't happen. We have 20 hours in September already. So they're at present super close, and remember they're warming up with 3 degrees before the end of the century. So they are really close to the limit and they are at risk. Sorry to bear sad news. So we also asked the question, then does acclimation better? Maybe they're used to it. If you acclimate the larvae, then they can still perform even if you warm them up. So we again take this particular urchin, Lithocynus variegatus, and we rear the larvae for 8 days and measure their physiological performance. I have other data. I'm only going to show you the respiration data. So this is a cool tool that we use. This is an oxygen plate reader. So basically, there are teeny little vials inside. Each of them have a graph corresponding here. There are 24 of them. They have a little sensor at the bottom, and it's sensitive to oxygen and light. So when the oxygen binds to it, it reflects less light. So, and then there is an LED that goes through, and then you can measure simultaneously a lot of small individual respiration at the same time. So you daisy chain this play reader up to 10 of them. So we daisy chain 3 at a time. So we are measuring around 100 oxygen respiration in one go. So what do we find? So the gist of it is, if you look at the temperature at which you observe the respiration, it goes down regardless of rearing temperature. It makes sense. Metabolic depression, remember the curve? You're at the hot end, so performance is dropping. But if you look at the rearing temperature, it's interesting because if they're reared at 32 degrees, they are always lower. So you could argue that they're already either stressed out, so they're always respiring less. That could be one way. Or if you can think about it as, if they're already warm, the drop from 26 to 29, the drop from 29 to 32 seems to be a little smaller compared to those that is reared at 26. So perhaps we are either acclimating, or we could argue that we are selecting. So those that didn't get cooked are better at performing. And we're doing a little bit more work to figure that out. So quick summary. Tropical sea urchins are living very close to the physiological limit. 32 degrees, they are cooked. But you gotta remember, one size does not fit all. Tolerance varies significantly through autogeny. What an adult can take is not representative of what an early life stage can take. So don't apply the adult variable for everything. And it seems fertilization to be more robust than early cleavage. And building on this, what my lab currently doing is a dynamic energy budget model. So basically, you can imagine everything goes in as a pie, and you divide energy in different ways. So we are building one for a larvae and comparing to published models on adult. And preliminary is quite different. So acclimation also affects physiological performance. So which means when you design your experiments, think about how you're acclimating your organisms, because you will get very different interpretation if you didn't acclimate your animals. Okay, so that's warming.
And it's time to talk about the evil twin of global warming, which is ocean acidification. So this work is done in two other places. So we were in Panama. Now we are moving to Sweden, the Seven Lothian Center in Kristineberg, mostly work that I did during my postdoc days, and done in Hong Kong. This is my university, on the snail that I was introducing you guys to. So I know that Christy was here last week, and you guys should be expert on ocean acidification already because she probably talked about that. So quick recap, ocean acidification refers to the dissolution of anthropogenic or carbon dioxide in the air anyway into the seawater, and then dissociate. And the net outcome is an increase in proton, decrease in carbonate ion. So it's not just changes in pH, but also changes in carbonate chemistry that impact the organism. You might wonder why we care, because if you look at IPCC prediction, at the turn of the century, we're expecting the global average is a 0.3 decrease. So it matters because pH is on the log scale, a 0.3 decrease is a 100% increase in proton concentration. So small change in pH, actually big change in proton. So it matters. So a lot of people study that. I know some of you probably do here. This is how we do it in our lab. We do a mass flow control pre-mix gas system. So basically we have mass flow controllers and we pre-mix air that is scrubbed of CO2 with CO2 at a known concentration at a fixed rate. And we continuously bubble our jars to achieve the desired carbonate chemistry. And then we do the standard best practice thing that we measure total pH, alkalinity, and DIC. So we do all that in-house. And we calibrate that with Andrew Dixon in Scripps to make sure that we're doing everything on the snuts. So what do we find? This is not juice. I think many of you would have heard this. It's ocean acidification reduced growth and calcification. So gonna give you just two examples. We have a lot more that show similar results. So if you look at the urchins here, the pictures are all on the same scale. So they are bigger at normal pH and lower at the pH that is predicted for the turn of the century, and even lower at an extreme pH 7.3. And if you try to quantify it, you can measure their length every day. So midline body length is from here to there, and you can plot it on a graph that is looking like this with age and midline body length. You can find out that they have different slope, and the slope would be your growth rate. So we've seen that many times in many different urchin species. And when my student worked on this particular snail, Capitula onyx, again, the California Cyphalimpid, with different pH, you also see normal pH has slightly higher growth rate than the decreased pH. And when he done an SEM, looking at the shell, so snails are great because the juvenile shell are kept, and then these layers are what the larval shell is kept, and then the juvenile shell is add on, so you can tell what happened during the larval stage. If you look at the control, you can see a lot of specks on top. So those are crystalline structure, and they're being eroded away as the pH decreases. So what we find in our lab is very consistent with what other labs found. So that's not quite, that's not fun enough. So what people actually, people usually attribute these changes in growth to different energy acquisition or allocation. So are they eating enough food? Or how are they defining the energy to deal with the excess protons? So that's what people think. But knowing they grow differently doesn't seem very satisfying because it doesn't translate into any ecological function. So we're actually interested in what does it mean if they grow differently, especially for urchins. Morphology affects the organism's ability to do a lot of key ecological functions, like food capture or predator avoidance. So this is an example of the sea urchin again. Now I stained it with a tubulin stain, so all the little hairs, the cilia on it, are like bright green, so this is not an upside down tarantula. So it's all the hairs that is on the urchin larva. And the video that you were seeing is the larva capturing food. So you can see that they're beating this hair so that they are both capturing food and swimming. So that's how they eat. So you can imagine if they have longer arms, then they would have more area to drive the flow. Then they can capture more food. And if they're not growing, you might imagine they're not eating as much. Another way of thinking about it is that they might not be able to swim. You would think a larger individual can generate more lift just by being bigger. So we can think about that, and swimming can be think of a function of both biomechanics and behavior. Behavior and biomechanics, what does it mean? So this is an example that I did way back in graduate school. If you swim the sand dollar larva at 20 degrees, this is what the tracks look like. Compared to when you swim them at 12 degrees, they're going at much narrower path. So their speed is reduced when it is cold because the viscosity of the water is higher, but they just swim slightly differently. So the analogy of a human is, I'm 5 foot even, my stride is limited by the biomechanic constraint of how long my feet are, 27 inches even, and my behavior would modulate how I use my feet. The behavioral difference would be how nervous I am right now compared to how fast I'll run when there is a lion introduced in this room, compared to how leisurely I feel when this talk is done and I'm moseying over to get a beer. So that's the difference in behavior. So we need to measure both. We need to both measure the biomechanics, so the shape, as well as how they actually behave. So how do we measure behavior? So we do a lot of video motion analysis in my lab. This is one example of looking at how organisms swim in moving water. So it's actually not as high-tech as people think it is. So this is a custom-made camera modified from a webcam, mounted with a special CCTV lens, and this is what we call a shear tank. So basically, one end we have hot water, and the other end we have cold water. So it has a temperature gradient. Because of that, it drives the water moving up on one side, down on the other, with an average of the temperature in the middle being equal. So this is what the video looks like. So once we get the video, we use a customized software to remove the background. So this is sped up. They don't go as fast. The teeny little faint thing at the back that you see is tracer particles. They're algal cells. The big things like this are the urchin larvae. So what we then do is we threshold the video for size and brightness, so only our target, in this case, things that are of urchin larva size and of that particular brightness is being selected. Then what we do is we basically pull it into MATLAB and play connect the dots. So we recreate individual trajectories. So the background color shows you the movement of the water, so up on one side, down on the other. And these are individual trajectories of the urchin larvae tract for 3 minutes. So this method do not require somebody sitting there to click, and we can do thousands of individuals at the same time. So that's why it's quantitative and it's quite powerful. So what do we find? Because if we see a difference in growth, and I told you the biomechanics should change, you might expect a change in swimming. So I set forth to do this acidification experiment as my final chapter, you know, on my thesis, or maybe as a postdoc. I thought that would be the easiest thing ever to write up. On day 8, I did it in still water. So control pH 8.1, 7.7, 7.3. So for each track, what we can then do is to calculate a lot of different parameters. Growth speed is just the derivative of the whole track. You can imagine I can take start to finish, I can calculate how many turns they make, and all that, but I'm only showing you this particular data because it's easy to understand. So at pH 8.1, it seems like in shear and still water on day 8, control condition larvae are swimming better than those that acidify. So I was like, great. And moral of the story, right, do not repeat an experiment if it already works. So if you... Actually, I take it back. That's not true. What is actually what is telling us is that you have to watch everything through ontogeny. It's the same thing that I was telling you in the case study number one. What happened in one stage does not represent what happened in the next. So we also see this interesting changes in pattern when you look at it at a different time. So if you then do the overall statistics, however you test it, and I have repeated that with four different species of urchins, I keep repeating the same pattern, is that acidifications do not affect the age-specific speed. That is, if I compare an acidified larvae that is 10 days old to a normally reared larva that is also 10 days old, the swimming speed is very comparable. Statistically, no difference. So what it tells us is that it seems like there is some kind of behavioral plasticity, so they can catch up. Maintaining this kind of swimming speed could have some implications. Compromise other function, maybe they couldn't eat, so we are doing clearance experiments. Or if nothing changes, it would mean that they might get to the settlement site before they're ready because they're too small. Or they would settle at a site at a smaller size than that compromised growth later on. In our experiment, we also see a lot of this. So some of you might probably heard of the story of never cut a sea star in half because a lot of echinoderms are capable of regenerating. So in urchins, their larvae are actually capable of budding, so they can pinch off part of themselves and that form a new individual. So we also reported budding in at least two different species of urchin when we acidified them. So it seems like there is a lot of short-term strategy that they're doing. If environment is really tough, make another one of myself, but we are both smaller right now and we will deal with it when we have to later on. So what it seems to us is that there is a lot of plasticity, but they might be short-term solution, short-term fixes, and a long-term, the larvae likely have to pay a price. So we talk about ocean acidification causing changes in growth, but no change in behavior, suggesting plasticity, but that's just looking at the larva. We are not thinking about the whole system. The next logical step is, how does acidification change ecological interactions? And we ask a very simple question. What about the food that the larvae eat? So, because if the impact of OA is just energy allocation, feeding them more would solve the problem. And people have done that experiment. If you increase food concentration, very often the negative effect of ocean acidification can be remediated. But the food quality also matters. So acidification means you're putting more carbon dioxide in the seawater. Plants love carbon dioxide, so they're growing a little faster. What it translates into is more carbon, less nitrogen, and this is data from my lab. If you grow the standard larval food, Isochiasis galbana, at different pH, C2N ratio goes up, so there's more carbon, and other people have measured the polyunsaturated fatty acids. Similar result, less polyunsaturated fatty acid. So it means as pH goes down, food quality also goes down. So then my very talented PhD student, Seldi, did this experiment. So what he did is let's rear the larvae at low pH, but also their food at different pH, and see if there is an interaction between food quality and the performance. So he used this snail, again, it's the slip limpet here in California. So what he did was look at rearing pH and then look at different diet. There's no effect on mortality or growth of diet or respiration. So we were scratching our head and asked the question why. And I told Sally, have you done clearance experiment? And he was like, no. I was like, let's do that. So what we found was very interesting. So again, rearing pH is on the x-axis. The different colored bars represent the different diet quality. Green is the algae that is grown in normal seawater. Acidified seawater is the brown bar, so quality of food decreases as the color gets more dark. So what we see very clearly is across all rearing pH, if you feed them not very good food, they eat more. So again, we see behavioral plasticity. So they increase the clearance rate when the diet quality is bad. Nice solution. it only works if there is an overabundance of food, and food is specially distributed. So poor Sally's big chapter is doing a food queue seeking experiment. So we're putting in a queue. This is a bag of algae, and we're tracking how the larvae are hunting them down. Preliminary result is that it seems like they are not very good at doing their hyper diffusive random walk if they are acidified. So they're not going in the right path, is what we are seeing. So stay tuned for that. So quick summary of all the ocean acidification stuff is that OA often negatively impact growth and calcification, like the picture shown here, normal to acidified. But we see a lot of phenotypic plasticity, such as the swimming in sea urchin, or if we see difference in clearance rate in the slippery limpet. One interesting remark that I would like to make is I keep alluding to this slippery limpet is non-native to Hong Kong. We are trying to test if this hypothesis all invasive species are more robust, and that's why they're invasive. So we're following up on that. And these hypotheses, this response incur long-term costs, so short-term solution. But having variability is good. It might be basis for selection to act upon. So if there is some plasticity, it might not be all bad news. Some organism may be able to cope. So the last story is going to be very short, I promise, is on microplastics. So the reason why I want to put this in there is I've only been talking about climate change related stressors. We got to bear in mind, everything is happening at the same time as humans are living and we're putting other things in our marine waters, and we should not forget about that. So we're going to talk about microplastics, two organisms, and this is the only time that we have an adult because it's a beautiful project by an undergrad. So just to orient you, microplastics are plastics that are smaller than 5 millimeter in diameter, I call it Huloa. It can come from direct industrial production, like big salt in China, or it's degradation of bigger pieces of plastic. It's the major pollutant in the ocean. If you think about all the plastic that is floating at sea, over 90% of them are microplastic. So big problem. And if you have to have some number, there is over 250,000 tons of them, quite a bit. So what did we do? Again, a lot of people have studied there is negative impact if you put microplastic in there, you impact cellular function or immune system, especially in worms. But very rarely do people actually look at how the organism functions as an organism as a whole. So my very smart undergraduate student, Julia, decided to do this for her senior thesis. So she took a perinensis of this worm. Basically, it's a bait. So very commercially important in China. We find them everywhere in our shawl. And what she did is she did an amputation experiment. A lot of polychaetes can regenerate the terminal segments if you cut them off. So what Julia asked the question was, okay, if they are living in the sediment and I put microplastic of a known size in the sediment, I cut that tail off, will they mistaken it as food? And how does it affect their regeneration? Pretty simple experiment. So what she did was she cut the tail off, marked the segment that she cut, and then count the segment as percent that is being regenerated. So control is the circle at two different concentrations, and she did two different size of beats. So what you can see, obviously, especially at high concentration, regeneration is compromised when there is a presence of microplastic. But what we found and think that is very interesting is that the effect is size and concentration dependent. So it seems like the small beads and the big beads are doing slightly different things, with the small beads being a little bit more detrimental. So we are following up on that, and stay tuned. Our paper should come out very soon in Marine Pollution Bulletin. My other student, Abby, my PhD student this time, asked the other question. Well, that's adult. Let's go back and feed the larvae. But this time we asked the question, if we feed them as larvae and not feed them as a juvenile when they settle, so we remove the toxicant, so they should be able to catch up. So or the term that we commonly refer to as legacy effect or carryover effect, to see if the experience in one life stage affects the subsequent stage. So what Abby did is she reared this larvae with elbow cells and microplastic at a low or high ratio, and then she waited until they settle, and then she rescued them. Some of them she take the plastic away, some of them she keeps giving them plastic. What we found is that even after, this is after 3 months, the growth rate is still compromised. So what this tells you is that if you experience distress as larva, even if the stressor is removed, or microplastic at least, you're still lagging behind. My student is a much more talented artist than I do, so this is how she put her story in a comic form. So when they were a larva, there's very little effect, so she's saying, well, just a few microplastic, I'll be okay. And then at the end, there's too much. We actually see an earlier, faster settlement, so stunning growth, I better settle faster and catch up later. Then the normal guy's like, sorry, bursting your bubble, you're still growing slower, even if the plastic is removed. So this paper should come out in think Environmental Science and Research very soon. So what have we found about plastic? Again, we see negative effect on growth, but this time we also show negative effect on the whole organism function. They cannot regenerate. And even at the same concentration, different sizes of beads have different toxicity. Small beads seems to be more detrimental. So stay tuned, we're doing a new set of experiments with plastic pellets. So it actually represents the fragments that you see in your sediment trap or in your actual pump to look at how the fibers and fragments would do if we put them in. And we also see net legacy effects. So basically what the story tells us is that even if the discharge is removed, the problem will persist. So it's not just about hoarding the microplastic input as one thing, but then it doesn't mean that the problem will go away immediately. There is probably some lag time. So I promised you sneak peek because that's not complete. I told you climate change is happening. Humans are still putting other things in, which means that the next step would be putting two things together. So we are doing a lot of interactive stressor work in my lab. Why? Because activity level of many pollutants are pH dependent. Prime example, trace metal, especially copper. The bioavailability, how likely copper are likely to bind to organic ligand, as well as the speciation of copper. Is it 2+, is it other things? It's pH dependent. So we did preliminary experiments to look at different pH level with and without copper addition. It seems like abnormality increase if there's an interactive effect between copper and pH. We have more data on respiration and bioaccumulation too. And another one that my very talented PhD student is doing is pharmaceutical. More precisely, is fluoxetine, or commonly known as Prozac. How many of you work on fish? So you probably have heard the story about Nemo not being able to respond correctly to predator cues under ocean acidification condition because their GABA receptor is messed up. So we are asking the second part of the story. Fluoxetine, or Prozac, is a serotonin reuptake inhibitor, but the action is actually opposite. So decrease in pH, it will not be active. So acidify them, suddenly your Nemo will be a very happy fish. And does it mean that there were antagonistic effect with ocean acidification? So that's why we're collaborating with Brian Brooks and Baylor's College and doing a lot of solid state extraction. And this is the part that is actually kind of interesting. This is Hong Kong control Prozac, which means strict seawater from outside a marine lab. We have 17.9 nanogram per liter of fluoroxidine. So I don't know, maybe there's actually a lot of sad people around me and I didn't notice, and we are having fluoroxidine in our seawater. And we are doing a territorial-wise search to see how much fluoroxidine we have. And Abby is doing experiment with that with lower pH and Prozac activity. So, told you a bunch of work. What do I want you to remember? Well, first and foremost, I hope you walk away thinking, marine organisms have complex life history, and the early life stage are very important. They're vulnerable, but they shape population dynamics. Climate change-related stressors, like warming and acidification, likely to have negative impact. But there's the but. Sensitivity depends on species, biogeographic distribution, life history, age, genetics of the family. I've only shown you some of the result. I've only talked about life history and age. Talk a little bit about species, like the urchin comparison with the slipper limpet. If you're interested, I can tell you about the rest of the story. We have biogeographic range and genetics data too. The other thing that is very important to remember is that plasticity is there. So there's some room for them to cope. It's not all lost. Some organism might survive, so it's not a gloom picture. Climate change, everything died. It's probably not going to be like that. And last thing is that climate change does not act alone. Other anthropogenic stressors are equally important. So if you think about it, if I put copper pollution there and copper kills the larvae first, it's a filter before it even gets to future climate scenario. So don't forget about the other anthropogenic stressors. They might act as a filter right now as well as present day extreme. So with that, I fix your time. I have to thank the Biological Oceanography Lab for hosting all the amazing food. Colleen for inviting me. Funding of my work usually comes from three places, a research grant council in Hong Kong, Crouser Foundation, and the Smithsonian. And my collaborator that is just for the work that is shown here, Rachel, Sam, and Brian, everybody in the lab. And last but not the least, I encourage you to figure out what we do in chanlab.ust.hk. And the next website is my latest pride and joy. We actually did a Hong Kong water biodiversity survey for plankton, and we only identify the larvae. So if you're interested in checking out pretty pictures like that, or figure out who they are, so go to Hong Kong crab larvae, and you will find some of the photo ID guys. So with that, I'd like to thank you and give you all an honest invitation to visit us in Hong Kong at HKUST. Our university is really young. It's only 25 years old, but it's the number one in the world in university under 50 years old. We rank 44 in the world according to Times Education. I don't even believe in that, whatever. But what is important is, I know here, you guys, most of you are master's students. We do have paid internship for master's students to come to Hong Kong for any time between 2 to 6 months. So if you're interested, you're more than welcome to shoot me an email. I'm at KarenChan@ust.hk. There's only one Karen Chan on faculty. So check us out and come visit us in Hong Kong. With that, I thank you and welcome any questions. Thank you.
In the second case study, the ocean acidification case study, it seemed like the intermediate pH had actually a greater differential effect than the lowest pH. Do you have any implication for why that might be? Any ideas?
Yes. Very good eye. I will try to get back to that slide. So, what we think is that it's a very unique situation here in Hong Kong. Is that Hong Kong have super big pH fluctuation because we are very coastal and we have an estuary influence. So what we hypothesize is that these animals are pre-adapted to low pH already. And so that's why maybe 7.77 is kind of actually normal for them. So it doesn't really do much. So and you're like, but then 7.4, they're seemingly doing better. You're actually talking about this one. You're talking about here, right?
Yeah.
This is not, so this is ABB if you do statistics. So sorry, I didn't put the groupings on there. So, but yeah, there is this trend that there is the dip in the middle. So what we think is compare, the maximum is a 10% difference, so we don't think it's significant. That's the first caveat. The second caveat is that we think organisms in Hong Kong, because it's so coastal, they're used to it. And the third thing that we're thinking is that if you are really acidifying, we think they're actually eating more. And it seems from our clearance experiment that is what is happening. So maybe the difference in growth is actually because they eat more. So if for a very accurate experiment to do, and that's why we're going to do the dynamic energy budget model, is because then now we're controlling how much is going in, how much is actually allocated and translated into growth. So we can then do a fair comparison, because if we don't control how much growth go in, we can do a fair comparison that way. Is that a long way of answering your question?
Yes.
Question?
In the first scenario, do the young in the life history actually live long enough to have a time to acclimatize to anything?
Okay, so the question is, does the young live long enough to acclimatize? I don't think it's the young that is acclimatizing, per se. So in the first case study, what we do is we just rear them for a couple of days at different temperature, right? So this is relevant because the planktonic larval duration is usually 2 weeks. So half of it is at a different temperature. So in that case, it's a very short-term acclimation. But if you're thinking about long-term evolution, what we think is happening is selecting for groups of family that are more plastic, or they have genes that can cope with, for instance, they have more proton pump that they can upregulate. And in that case, then it's the mom that would make babies that are slightly different. So to answer your question, I'm going to give you one example. Not here. We also work on another invertebrate, which is a bryozoan. They're perfect because they get stuck on the ground, they have non-feeding larvae, easy to measure. So what we're doing is acclimatizing the moms to different pH, and we're measuring the size of the babies that come out. And it seems like when they're stressed, they make fewer as big as baby. So then it seems like the adult is then positioning differently than the babies can cope differently.
In the lab, is there like a, I need a, like a day rating or something. Is there an, a time to acclimatize that has been verified?
Ooh, that's a very hard question. Do we do a standard time? It depends on what species you work on. Nobody ever published that. So the only published study was to do in polar sea urchin. And that experiment is very hard to repeat. What Emily Flost did was she did urchins for directly spawn them and look at what they do, keep the mom and dads under low pH for 3 months, then see what the babies do, and then she keep the mom and dad in low pH for 2 seasons and come back 2 years later and look at what they would do. And the result was completely different every time she does it. So I wish I could give you the magic answer and say keep them 48 hours.
When you do a temperature experiment, I think it seems to me, I could be very well wrong, the reaction is the immediate reaction to temperature. And the experiments are never set to define a possibility to acclimatize.
Yes, it depends on what you're trying to measure. If I'm measuring what is your respiration rate at 25 degrees, it doesn't matter how you acclimatize, right? But if I care about what's your behavior in the long term, can you survive, then the long term history matters.
So, you know, for these urchins and some of the species that look to be pretty impaired by these stressors associated with climate change, do there appear to be some individuals, you know, in the population that are performing just as well as the ones in the control, so you should have a little hope, or is it, or does the whole population seem to be
That's the part of the genetics that I didn't show. So if I repeat the experiment with 5 different moms, chances are I will have 1 super mom and 1 very doopy mom. So yes, there is genetic difference. And one very beautiful and elegant study is done in actually USC, because they have the one and only group of oyster lines. So Dennis Hedgecock has been breeding oysters for 25 years. So he has perfectly controlled genetics. So who's mom, who's dad, they have genetic purebred. And when they do purebred lines, what they find is some lines are much better than the other. But what is crazy about that is that if you do differential gene expression, some lines might be upregulating the proton pump by 3.1 fold, but the actual proton pump activity doesn't go up. So there is genetic difference, but it doesn't mean that it directly translates into gene expression. So there is something that we still don't quite understand to go from the genome to the phenotype right now. But yes, the short answer to your question is yes, there is genetic difference. Some groups are more resilient than the others. Even in the budding thing, like I would have some mothers that have 70% budding and some mother has 5%. And we don't know why.
I have a kind of a follow-up. Do you think there's some way to translate that into the real world then? If you know there's diversity, you know that there are some super moms out there, and you're finding on average that you get this reduced fitness with temperature, but you know there's going to be some out there. Are those ones just going to take over? Is there some way to have a predictive ability?
Perfect question. Two parts. The first part is some people are actually trying to apply that. In the coral world, Ruth Gates in Hawaii is doing beautiful experiments. She is actually trying to grow heat and oil resilient corals by heat selecting colonies. So they pop the coral polyps off and then they heat stress or acidify them, pick the survivor, then transplanting the survivor out to the field, thinking that this is a way of growing a population that will survive better. So that's one part. And the other part that people are using that, and it's very applicable to California, is population, they call it, it's a planned concept, it's climate variability hypothesis. So it's postulated that organisms that live in an environment that have more fluctuations intrinsically has more plasticity, so they're better with coping with dealing with stress. It seems very logical, right? So here in California, it would translate into upwelling site would have a population that might take over. So you can imagine doing a very long-term experiment. And I don't know, maybe Gretchen Hoffman is going to do that before you know it, is to look at purple sea urchin population up and down the coast and see if there is a sweep from stronger upwelling site to be